test your memory. I'm going to read you a list of words, and when I'm done,
the C3 app is just again, Cleveland Clinic put this out.
We'll repeat this three separate times.
You can get it on your iPad, or you can just use a paper pencil version and get online.
Finger, penny, blanket, lemon, insect.
Let me just
go ahead.
25807376549465314 on the iPad, so it's an iPad app. 1545926553186453752.
Yep.
Clinical reaction time testing. So this is a dowel that we took, a dowel that got it from Home Depot. We drill out a hockey puck, and then we embed it with some epoxy into the hockey puck. So the hockey puck just creates weight as they drop, and then you do that measurement.
There you go.
I'll show you. This is part of the VOM, so you can hear the metronome in the back. So they're turning their head in step with the metronome. So that's horizontal saccades. This is vertical saccades. So looking up and down, or this is the twisting, excuse me. And the simple question after you get done doing this is, do you have a headache? Are you dizzy from this? That's what you're looking for. This is near point of convergence, so I brought some tools with me. We'll have someone come up and do this. And then I have a tandem gate line here as well. Quickly as you can, turn around, go back, stay on the line. Just a fun fact. Does anybody know that, you know, as part of the SCAT tool, you can actually do tandem gait? It's usually very fine print. Anybody in here been working doing tandem gait as part of SCAT 5? How many of you are doing BEST as part of SCAT 5? BEST testing? Yeah, the balance testing. But the tandem gait, my colleague Dr. Buckley at Delaware, he's really found the tandem gait is much more sensitive to changes post-concussion than the BEST test. The BEST, there's so much variation with it. And so you'll see in a second here, I'm going to show you some of the videos that we have a platform that we use with a company called TechScan to kind of take the guesswork out of it, the testing process for us. This is the SCAT-5 symptom checklist. So you have this as part of your packet. You know, SCAT-5's, it's good. This is an important part of this. Again, you're not showing the athlete when they come in the second time. You're just using a different sheet. So, you know. Have them, sometimes you have to look over their shoulder, they might have questions about this, but I think it's written in a form that's pretty simple for student athletes to understand. This is the BSI 18. You know, this is an area of athletic training that we're starting to embark a little bit more, and I know Tim Neal is here today to speak to you a little bit about mental health, but this is something that we do on the front end with our student athletes. They fill out the BSI 18 brief symptom inventory, and basically there's a few different dimensions here. So it's basically about, you know, your overall body, somatization. There's a depression dimension. There's kind of this general anxiety, and then there's this panic that's measured in there. So these are the different constructs, if you will, that this tool is actually getting at. And if you remember back to what I said before, is that if a student athlete scores 2 or higher on question 17, that they're the fear of their life, they're going to kill themselves, we have to notify the team physician. A lot of times what happens is the athletes are doing this online quickly, and they just hit the wrong key. But nonetheless, we have to bring them in and check them out. So brief symptom inventory, I think you have that as part of your packet. So each of those different constructs. Here's the mobile map BEST. So we've partnered with a company called TechScan. They make pressure sensor mats. So you can see here that the student athlete is actually balancing on a foam mat, which is part of the BEST, right? So there's two different surfaces, the firm or foam surface. And then you might see underneath the mat is actually a little mat. So it's a very thin mat. And that measures foot pressure. And so as they're balancing there, it has a built-in score for errors. I argue, look at, when we do best testing, there's a lot of error associated with it. The beauty of this device is it normalizes the error, because you and I would probably score it differently, okay? At least the error is normalized with this. So I'll just show you the demo here of this test. So this is a very difficult surface, right? So single leg stance on a foam surface. So you can see it's connected to the USB port of our laptop computer. And then you zero in on the laptop. And basically, at the end of that test, it would tell us how many errors they had. He had quite a few because he was constantly touching down. That's a classic error associated with the best test. Okay? So the best is part of the SAC, right, so, or the SCAT 5. MPC testing, so this is near point of convergence. So we can do this one of two ways. This is the more expensive way. So if you go into the ophthalmologist, optometrist, they would have this accommodative ruler. This is an accommodative ruler. You can get this on Amazon for about $75, okay? And the accommodative ruler has marked on it in centimeters distances. So you start out here, has this little plastic collar, and then on that plastic collar, we have the letter T in a 14-point font. So we put this to the forehead, we slide it like this, or the athlete slides this, and when they stare at that letter T, and they begin to see double, what's happening? Their eyes are converging. That's why it's called near point of convergence. Okay? Near point of convergence. Okay? And when they see double, you stop. And then the beauty of the accommodative ruler, it tells me the exact measurement in centimeters. Now, I don't expect athletic trainers working in a high school setting to go out and buy a Barron's ruler or an accommodative ruler. So our colleagues at Pittsburgh created, and I'll show you this. You watch the video here first. So here's the athletic trainer just pushing it. When she sees double, she stops. We measure that distance. Okay. And then here is using the tongue depressor. So the TD is the tongue depressor. So leave it to athletic trainer ingenuity. Take a tongue blade. We put the letter T on it in a 14-point font. We have the athlete hold it out here at a distance arm lengths away. And then they move it at whatever self-selected speed towards their nose. And when they see double, they stop. And then we take that measurement. So you'll see that here in the video. And most athletes, it's usually 2 centimeters or lower before they get to, they stop, so it's 2 centimeters away. The concussion literature tells us that anything greater than 4 centimeters indicates that the athlete is probably concussed. So again, it's a matter of, okay, I do this test, so what, right? So what? If you have a baseline, that's a good thing because you want them close to their baseline. But if you don't have a baseline, you look at normative data, and the normative says if they can't reach a point 4 centimeters or away and they have double vision, they're probably telling you that there's something going on with the visual component in their brain. Again, very simple test, and again, something that we can use clinically. This is the tandem gait now. I will put a qualifier on this. You're going to actually hear in the background. So we're actually doing a dual task with this as well. So you saw earlier Tori do the tandem gait. Now we're making that a little bit more challenging. Now watch.
Drama.
A-M-A-R-D.
C. curse.
Has to spell it backwards.
S-R-U-C.
White.
E-T-I-H-W.
Right? Just like counting back 100 minus 7, right? Challenging that athlete. Or remember those digits, repeat them back in reverse order, right? That's a difficult task. So you can imagine an athlete with a concussion, this is very difficult. So what we've done is we've taken this tandem gait and we've elevated it one step further to where we do dual tasking. Okay, so we do dual tasking where they spell words backwards, have to go out a series of numbers, 100 minus sevens, okay, while they do that task. That's a three meter line, okay, and it's a timed task, so they are to do it as quickly as they can. So staying on the line, turn around and go back. So complete 360 and they turn around and go back. This is the trail making test. You guys all have this as part of your little handout. This is as simple and as easy as just, making a copy of this from the document I gave you, or go online and make a copy of it. Our colleagues in neuropsychology, they do a lot of this paper and pencil test. So if you refer an athlete to a neuropsychologist for a workup post-concussion, they probably will do a lot of these traditional paper and pencil tests. They might do some computerized tests as well, but these are very traditional tests. So trail making, very simple. So the first one, you take your pencil, you find the start number one, and it's just connect the dots as quickly as you can. Now, if you make a mistake, you cannot lift your pencil from the paper. Pencil needs to remain in contact with the paper. So it's quickly connect the dots. If you make a mistake, you retrace back with pen still intact. And so that is, again, a time test. Okay? Very simple time test. Do you have a baseline? Good. What typically happens post-concussion is they find this difficult. Not so much trail A. This is trail A. Trail B, if you see in your diagram, trail B is connect 1 to A to 2, 2 to B, B to 3, 3 to C, so on and so forth. So it's a little bit more challenging from a cognitive perspective. It's going to add time. Okay? Usually they double their time. So with the time that they get with trail A is probably doubled for trail B. Obviously, an athlete with a concussion is going to take them a little bit more time to do that. So that's a very simple, easy task. But our colleagues in neuropsychology use this all the time. This is the groove pegboard testing. This is a challenge for me when I travel to bring this onto the plane. Okay? 25 grooved pegs. Plastic. Oh, this guy's making a bomb. So I have to put a little note in my suitcase to my TSA colleagues. I'm going South Padre Island, giving a workshop on concussion. The groove pegboard test is not a bomb. It's a testing device. They always put a little smiley face on the handout that I put inside my luggage. Anyways, groove pegboard test. You actually use it with both your right and left hands. Okay? So most of us probably are right hand dominant, so one is your dominant, the other is your non-dominant hand. Now the interesting part about these groove or the pegs is that they have a little ledge to them or a little edge to them, so they're not completely round. So you can imagine the fine motor dexterity that it takes for you to put this into the pegboard. And so you move as quickly as you can across left to right, left to right, left to right, 25 pegs, time test. Usually the non-dominant hand takes a little bit longer. So in my case, it would be my left hand, takes a little bit longer. And normal times are around a minute and 10 seconds or so. So that's the groove pegboard testing. And then lastly, I think, is the King-Devick test. You saw in the video the King-Devick test. You can still get these online. The King-Devick test patterns are still available to you, so you could make copies. This is the old King-Devick flip card test booklet. Okay, it's a plastic laminated test testing. But now King Divic is all gone computerized, so it's all an app. So you have to get the buy the app, and then you use it with your iPads. It's my understanding that King Divic is $20 per person per year. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. We're able to do it as part of our care consortium because we're part of that, and they gave us the site license for free. So we have a series of iPads. Our athletic trainers have iPads, so post-concussion they can do a King Divic test. That's very difficult for you guys to do that. However, you can get around that by just making copies of the cards themselves. And I think you see that in your handout. I think that's the last page shows you the King Divic patterns. So basically you start out, the first is the test demo card, and all of those numbers are connected by lines and arrows. So it's very easy for the athlete to read through that. 25834683674670153585837530. Did pretty good without my glasses on. Okay? But they're all connected. It's easy to do that. Well, then on the first test card, you see what we do is we take the arrows away. Okay? But again, it's a time task. And it's a cumulative time task. Okay? It's a cumulative time task. So card one is added to card two, is added to card three. So it's a cumulative time. King Divic, good test. Ocular motor function is something that we traditionally as athletic trainers have not looked at. So you can do that one of two ways. You can either use the tongue blade task here and do near point of convergence, or just do a simple King Divic test. And that can be done on the sideline, certainly in your clinical setting. And that's easy to do. And there are some time tasks out there, typically for a King Divic is in a collegiate population. We've seen them go in the range of 40 to 45 seconds is on average pretty normal. And obviously that time is going to be increased as you have a concussion. Okay? So a King Divic test, that's fairly easy to do that. Let me just go back, because one other thing I didn't mention was the clinical reaction time. So pretty difficult to shove one of those dowels with a hockey puck into your suitcase. Or into, for your case, into your athletic trainer's kit. So what we did was we went online to Amazon and we got these collapsible rulers. And so our athletic trainers, when they travel, because one of the tests that they have to do immediately post-concussion with our student athletes is clinical reaction time. We are not there. Our test team is not there if they're playing at North Carolina State. We're just not there, okay? So the athletic trainer does that. And so they have this into their kit. And so what we did was we just, again, embedded the hockey puck into that collapsible ruler. And when they do the clinical reaction time test, they can just give us that data from the road. They can just send us a text what that is. So typically we test within that first 6 to 8 hour window post-concussion, and we can do clinical reaction time testing. So if you wanted to do this, you could easily put this in your athletic training kit, and you could use that from a portable standpoint. And then in your clinic, you can have the long dowel if you want. The long dowel for us is all, we just measure it out. It's actually taped, and then we have it in increments of centimeters. And our colleagues at Michigan have done a lot in the area of clinical reaction time testing. And the other thing I need to mention to you about clinical reaction time is that your first question is, well, how do you get the time from that, right? Because I'm measuring a distance, right? So they sit here and you drop it, and you measure a distance, and they do that. Theoretically, they say you do that 8 times. You won't get an average. Well, that's still not a time, right? It's just a distance. Well, go online, right? And they actually have online, you can get a, where is my sheet here? where it converts each of those distances in centimeters to an actual time. There is my thing here. And so it's very simple. So somebody's already done the work. They've already done the calculations for you. Otherwise, you'd have to put this into an algebraic equation. Algebra, you know, that was junior year in high school. You know, I don't want to do that. Simple. So if the distance is 8 centimeters, they give you a time. And obviously, post-concussion, this time is, it's going to take them longer to catch that. So, you know, hopefully some of these things, normally when I'm doing this, I actually do a little hands-on workshop with a much smaller group than this, where you can do some hands-on stuff. There's still a few minutes before, I think Daryl's coming on after I speak, so we still have about 15 minutes. If any of you want to come up and see some of these tools, you're more than welcome to come up and see some of these tools. But again, hopefully today, you know, take-home points from my perspective is, I'm one of you. You know, I'm one of you guys. And I advocate for athletic trainers on a day-to-day basis because you are the experts. But to maintain that expert status, folks, we need to continue to change with the times. And that's changing the standard of care. We cannot rest on what we were doing years ago. We need to change. And hopefully what I've shared with you today is giving you the opportunity to go back and, you know, say, you know what? There's some of these simple things that I can impart that will make our concussion assessment better at whatever high school I'm at or whatever clinic I'm working at or whatever collegiate setting I'm working at. And that will make you a better athletic trainer, okay? And hopefully, you know, I've condensed this. And if any of you want this presentation, I don't know. I think I sent it. Natalie, I sent the presentation to you. It's probably as a PDF. But if anybody wants more information, just send me an email. My email address is my last name, kaminski@udel.edu. And I'm happy to share videos, whatever, because if it makes you better in the clinical setting, that's the most important thing to me. Keep doing what you're doing. You guys are doing a very, very important service, especially those of you working in high school setting. You don't necessarily get the praise, but I appreciate what you do. And very, very important. Questions? Yes. Go ahead, yeah. No, that's a good question. Her question was if someone's dyslexic, you know, that's a difficult time reading that the numbers in terms of the King-Devick test is going to be difficult. You need to account for that. You know, that's a star. You know, put a star next to that or an asterisk because, you know, it's those individuals will be a little bit more difficult for them to do that. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Yeah, no, that's a good point. You probably need to stay standardized because all the normative data on this is from the standardized testing. So that appears to be around a size 14 font, maybe 16 font. In terms of distance for them, it's the comfortable, whatever comfortable level the student athlete's at. So, you know, whatever level they would normally read at is good for them. But I do think that's a good question because if you make copies of that and the font's like a point, you know, an 8 font, I mean, that's difficult to see that. So you want to try to stay standard if you make copies, yeah. Good point. Good question. Yeah. Any other questions? Well, again, I appreciate you guys allowing me to come all this way to chat with you. Hopefully you found it useful and worthwhile. And after all, you got two EVPs for it too, right? So congratulations on that. And again, good luck to you.
Okay, guys, we're going to do some door prizes here for all of you that got up early this morning, got here at 8. See, though, everybody made it. Everybody's alive. It's all good. We are going to be selling the blue shirts out at the registration area. They're going to be, I know I told some people 10, they're going to be 12. Gonna be $12 a piece. We have to break even on them. So $12 a piece for the blue participant long sleeve shirts. And we have all sizes up there. So if you want to come buy one, they'll be selling them at the registration desk. All right, are we ready? Got one more card. Okay. First thing we're gonna start. Start with a beach bag. That is Chris Warren. Did I tell y'all these are limited edition bags? I've got 4 more of them to give away today. This one's going to Melissa Oach. She here? She won again. $25 Sea Ranch gift card. Domingo Cifuentes. Where's Domingo? Back in the back. We're going to give away a kayak ride at Paradise. It's going to Jaime Tovar. Where's Jaime at? Where's he at? Oh, I saw him this morning. Oh, too bad. Ruth Grasty, Dolby High School. Where's Ruth? Is she here? No? You don't want it? Okay. Eddie McGuire, Tyler Junior College. There he is right there, kayak ride. $15 Whataburger gift card. Matt Gross. He'll need that after last night. Oh, sorry, Matt. I didn't see you over there. This is a $25 Wingstop right down the street here. Joe Cruz, Eastside Memorial. Right there. $50 in cash. John Prosek, Harlingen High School. Let's see. This is a dozen golf balls from the brokerage store. CJ De La Garza, Taft High School. I know he's not here. Alex Benavidez, right there. Okay, we're going to give away from the brokerage store $50 to Applebee's. $50 to Applebee's. Lee Rodriguez, Harlingen High School. He was here, but he's not anymore. Hopi Alanis Webb, right there. We're going to give away a $25 gift card for Fandango Movies. Maria Lara McCollum. She here? Yep. Another beach bag. Jaime Perez, San Marcos High School. Where's Jaime? There he is. Oh, hurts. $50 in cash. $50 in cash goes to Vanessa Vallejo, Where's Vanessa? There she is, back there. Did I tell y'all these are special edition guides? Limited, right? And there's something inside of it, too. Sarah Anderson, Seguin High School. There she is, back there somewhere. $25 Whataburger gift card from the brokerage store. Alan Dinsmore, Hill College. Right there. Okay. $25 Sea Ranch. Natalie Evans, Aledo ISD. Where's she at? Right there. Okay. Another nicer beach bag with something in it. Phil Muskies. Where's he at? Oh, he's back there in the back.